So I'll be talking about scaling up data pipelines using Apache Parquet and Dask and the learnings we had while using this in our workflows. My short intro, I work as senior data scientist at Ecolab, where my work is related to building scalable data products. I work mostly in Python, SQL and data science. Yeah. Sorry. So Ecolab is a global leader in world hygiene and energy services and technology. All over the world, companies use our solutions to work towards more sustainable planet, and we find solution to world's biggest challenges: clean water, safe food supplies, and abundant energy and healthy environment. So typical machine learning systems have a data flow in which data is extracted out of systems. You do some transformation, machine learning models are fit, and then this data is again loaded back into a database from where it is used for various purposes like reporting or visualization. Now we can parallelize our machine learning systems based on clusters in data, for example, clusters on product group, customers, location, and scale this out. However, problem in this is, or the bottleneck is in extraction and loading of data from database. Also, the second problem is we can have multiple concurrent connections to extract data, but we have to load that data back with limited connections. As we have heard, Python in PyCon, it's used for various these purposes, web development, scientific computing, data science, and in lot of these use cases, Python is often used to move data in and out of databases. However, it's not the best tool when the data is very large and if it doesn't fit into memory. So Dask with Apache Parquet as a file format can be used for improved performance. So Apache Parquet as a file format, it comes from Hadoop ecosystem. It was invented in 2012 by Cloudera and Twitter. So at Twitter, they had these huge log files, and they wanted to store them more efficiently so that they can evaluate large queries on them. Eventually, in July 2013, it had its first release, and it became a top-level Apache project because it got used into various Hadoop ecosystem projects. Eventually, it had a general availability, in fall 2016, it had an support for Python and C++ for read and write. It is a state-of-art format in Hadoop ecosystem for storing data. And if you see lot of tutorials like Spark data frame tutorials, they usually use Parquet as an file format. So like I said, Parquet is a columnar data format, and I'll give a bit of explanation what does that mean. So example, if you have a two-dimensional data like this, so when you write the data, you need to pick whether you are going to write a data by row like this, or which is a traditional format, or by column. So by column. Now, so that's the main difference here. With row, it's straightforward. You write rows like this, and however, with column, it's other way around. So the benefit with columnar data is once you have data like this, you can encode a bunch of values of same type together, so you can have much efficient and smarter encodings. And also compression works much better when data is homogeneous. So for example, if you have text, number, and decimal values to compress, if you apply compression on it, it's less efficient. So some advantages of Parquet, because it's an columnar format, it's very good for vectorized operation. It has an very efficient encoding and compression, which results in smaller file size. We saw a reason why, and I'll share some benchmark afterwards. It supports predicate pushdown. What does that mean is, with predicate pushdown, you can only read the data that you need. For example, you can directly jump to 10,000 line of the data and just read the block of that data. It's also a language independent format, and hence if you have some framework in different languages, it can still share the data. So there are two typical habitats of Parquet. One are the query engines like Hive, Presto, and Drill, which uses it, and others are framework like Apache Spark or Hadoop MapReduce, which uses it for getting maximum performance from these framework. Also, there has been growing support to use Parquet by Pandas and Dask, with several benchmarks showing that you can get really good speed up for your application. So most of us know Pandas. Dask, like Jake explained in yesterday's keynote talk, it's and he gave a pretty good overview of the library. It's an flexible parallel computing library. So with Dask, what you do is you take a Python workflow, which you currently have, and you can easily scale it up. So let's have a look at Parquet file structure. As I said, it's an on-disk file format. So the files are stored on your disk or in S3 or Hadoop file system. Now each file is split up into row groups. So row groups are about 5 MB to 1 GB of data, and its number, it could be from 10,000 to 100,000 rows. Within a rows, you have column chunks. A row group have all the same columns, and all the columns in row group has the same length. And then you have these page units. These page units are basically within the column chunks that are used for compression and efficient storage. And at the end of the file, you have statistics. That is the metadata of the file. So hierarchically, a file consists of one or more row groups. A row group consists of exactly one column chunk per column, and column chunk consists of one or more pages. Now, the idea with Apache Parquet was a common need for an on-disk columnar storage. And there was a parallel project going on Arrow, which was related to common need for an in-memory format so that there is zero copy reads. So Wes McKinney, who is a developer of Pandas, he wrote a great blog about it in 2017. You can read, I've referred a link to that. Saying Apache Parquet, Apache Arrow, and 10 things I hate about Pandas. So he, along with other developers, they started this project for in-memory format of data, and to facilitate data exchange between different frameworks like Python, C++, and all these frameworks. So this basically gives a clear picture. With Arrow, what happens is you can directly utilize the memory with all these systems. If Arrow memory is not there, each system has its own internal memory, and lot of computation time is spent between serialization and deserialization. So So how does it look like to work with Python and Parquet? So the tabular nature of Parquet, it supports good fit to read into pandas or Dask data frames. With these two libraries, Fast Parquet and PyArrow. So Fast Parquet comes from a group which developed actually Dask, Matthew Rocklin and that group, and PyArrow comes from the Wes McKinney's group, the Arrow group. So reading a Parquet file in pandas or Dask data frame is very easy. We have a top level function, read Parquet, and you can pass a file path. So if you are interested in efficient reading of files, you should only specify the columns that you are interested. So for example, if I have here three columns, and I'm only interested in the location and the sale, I pass those columns, and so data from disk for only these columns is read. This is also called as column projection. And similarly, you can write it with a top-level function called toParquet. So data frames can be written in Parquet format. And if you see the syntax for pandas and Dask, it's actually similar. And we'll talk about compression a little bit afterwards. One other thing that you need to know if you care about reading large files efficiently is predicate pushdown. So for when you are reading large file, you want to read the columns that you are interested in, but also you want to skip the data that's not relevant to you. How does it helps? This saves IO load as data doesn't need to be transferred, and it saves CPU cycle because data doesn't need to be decoded. So to use predicate pushdown, you just need to pass a filter with the row groups with this filter syntax. Yeah, so it will basically only read the predicate from which the data is present. So Parquet file supports predicate pushdown because when you write Parquet files, it writes metadata and statistics like mean and max of the values. So when you read a Parquet file, this metadata is read first, then you can actually skip the whole row if your predicate doesn't matches it. However, to use this feature, you have to make sure that you write the data into disk into sorted order. Another important trick that you have to remember if you have to minimize data storage size on disk and to speed up reading later is dictionary encoding and filtering. This is very good fit for pandas categorical variable. So for example, if you have categorical data and its values are always high, medium, low, you can use dictionary encoding. So what you do here is you take all the values you have, you assign a code to those values, and this mapping of values and code is stored at the beginning of the beginning of the row group, and for every value you only use the code. Now if you want to filter the data, then you can check in the dictionary for the row groups if your predicate matches the row group, and then it just reads that data. So the performance penalty for adding dictionaries in this case is not that high. It's just about 1% of reading of that data. And it's especially helpful if you have not sorted the data and you still want to benefit from partial reading of the data. Also, whenever you have distributed systems or when you work with multiple customers that produce data, it makes sense to split the data into multiple files. Usually, this is done by hive partitioning scheme. So as you can see in the above screenshot, we have a Parquet file with name date, and this is partitioned by date and location, and then you have multiple Parquet files for it. So Dask can be used to create this type of structures, and Dask also can sense this type of structures and auto-detect these structures. And you can also then pass a predicate with predicate push down, and then it will read data only from that particular file. So you can also read data with Dask from various cloud storages. So this is an example. We are on Azure, so you just need to pass a storage option, and then you can directly read the files. So these are some benchmarks that we have obtained on NYC taxi data. So the original file is 2.54 GB uncompressed CSV. And if you write it to Parquet, if you see the file size, even the uncompressed Parquet file is less than half of the size of CSV. And one important thing to note is this is without dictionary encoding. So with dictionary encoding, you can reduce the file size more. And also the difference in the size, it becomes more significant when the size of data increases. So for example, I've seen some benchmark results. If the uncompressed CSV file is around 30 GB, the Parquet files are around 5 GB. So there are groups who have obtained this. So these are the benchmark for reading it into data frame. And so there are three different compression schemes that we have compared. And if you don't really care about which compression scheme to use, you can just go with Snappy. Yeah. So the usual data flow is you run a query in database. You pass it in as a columnar form to ODBC layer using PyODBC. The ODBC layer converts it into row form, and then pandas or Dask make it in columnar again. But ideally, we don't want our ETL workflows to have direct access to database because it can be bottleneck. So one of the solutions that people use is to bypass this ODBC layer is to export this data into CSV file. However, with use of CSV file, you basically lose all the data type information. So what has worked for us is we export the data from database in Parquet file to a cloud storage, and from there we run our machine learning models. There is huge benefit of using cloud storage and Parquet file, as now we can really scale our models, because cloud storage, for example, like Azure Data Lake, it scales much better than SQL. And also we don't have to synchronize our loading, because every job it inserts into a separate Parquet files, and we can work on that. And also data in Parquet files can be shared by different implementations like Spark. And we can also use query engines like Hive, Presto, Drill for analysis of data. Yeah, thank you. I'll take questions.
Hi.
Yeah.
So my question is, when we are talking about Parquet, so it is basically in our Hadoop ecosystem, right?
Yeah.
So if we have an existing cluster of say 100 or 150 nodes, so and if you want to leverage Dask, so do we have to install this Dask package on each node, or only the edge node is enough?
Sorry. Yeah. So Dask actually has its own clusters, right? When it depends how you want to use Dask. So usually what we do is initially just for development, you just use your own simple Dask cluster, which would be your local. And then afterward, it depends on where you are running it. So there it scales accordingly.
Hello?
Yeah.
So, that was a really good talk. And
thank you.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Hi. Really, thanks for the talk. I really got to know about things such as Apache Arrow and Parquet. And Apache Arrow as such is not a very well talked about thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
The community has not supported it as much as it has supported Dask and Parquet, right? So my question is that you compared Dask to Spark,
mm-hmm.
right? And you compared you presented Dask as a query engine as well as a compute or a processing engine, right?
Yeah.
But I would like to know how the internals of Dask work. How it works on a scale such as MPP, massive parallel processing, and how does it parallelly process files, and mostly how the deployment in Dask work, right? And where to deploy the Dask clusters, like if you see, you can deploy and the cloud options as well, right? Like you can deploy Spark clusters on AWS normal, using the MapReduce and stuff. So I would like to know about those things, if you have experienced such things.
Can you summarize? I think probably we can talk during lunch.
Okay, no problem.
Yeah.
That is a broad topic, I know.
Yeah.
Okay.
So what can you summarize? I'll just try.
Just talk about the parallel processing of Dask.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you for the talk. I'll definitely use it. Optimization for the workflow you suggested, this is like you have an Oracle data or something, rather than using your NodeBC connection, put it to cloud. But increases the cost, and most organizations would not like to do that due to privacy and cost. Do you have any suggestion on the ODBC layer level itself? You suggested a CSV, but then again we lose the properties. Is there any other technique that you tried that works slightly better than having just an ODBC connection, but also leveraging Dask and Arrow?
So actually the cost for using cloud storage is not that much. It's only when you extract data, that's when you are actually charged. So it's not that much. And to answer your question, there are some packages called open source package called Simple KV, which actually address this problem of how do we extract data with PyODBC. You can check Simple KV. Yeah.
Hi. How can we compare Parquet to HDFI, or what are the relative advantages between both of them?
Yeah. So there are some benchmarks actually comparing Parquet and HDFI. So if you see the file size with HDFI is reduced so much. I mean, if I would have put it into benchmark, it would have been less than Parquet files. But if you try to read data from that, it's slight. It's more than the Parquet file. And then again, you don't get these things if you want to just read the data that you are interested from disk. All these things, yeah, because it's not in columnar storage format.
Hi. Suppose I have one single CSV which is huge in gigabytes, right?
Yeah.
So is Dask applicable for that, right? How to read in memory, it's not a cluster. Suppose I'm having a single node.
Hmm.
So is Apache Dask Apache Arrow and Dask is suitable in this case?
Yeah, exactly. So basically what you can do is you can read that CSV.
Okay.
You can write it in Parquet, and as you can see the file size will reduce.
Okay.
And if you know data while writing the data, you encode the dictionary for the data. So all the categorical variables would be encoded. Then it will reduce the file size more. And then you can basically read whatever data you want.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So my question is in Cassandra or something, we import the database with CSV files. So pretty much straightforward, right? But Parquet is somewhat encrypted with these things.
Yeah.
So the write speed may reduce when we're importing at that places. So how to overcome that thing?
The write speed?
Write speed into the Cassandra or some databases while we are importing through files.
So when you are asking, you are writing CSV files right now,
yes,
in Cassandra.
Yes. Yes.
And if we use Parquet files, right?
Yes.
And then while reading the files or
while reading into Cassandra.
I don't think so. There should be a problem. Because what happens is the way the Parquet files are written, as I explained, while writing itself, the file statistics and everything is encoded there. So that's why it takes actually some time to write it, and that's the reason actually it's not using for streaming data also. But then it's a very good fit if you don't have a streaming data and you are interested in only reading some chunk of the data every time.